Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back Vic Gundotra.
Well, good morning. Welcome, everybody. It's great to see this room jam-packed so early in the morning. I hope you guys had a great time yesterday and a good time at the party last night. You know, it wasn't just us that had a great time yesterday. We had over 60,000 simultaneous viewers watch our show. That's pretty staggering. Because it is a global audience, throughout the day, that number increased, and total viewers yesterday was just topping out over 600,000 people. And so, we can't thank you all enough for the global enthusiasm that you've expressed for the hard work that we're doing. It's very, very gratifying. I hope all of you also enjoyed your Samsung tablets. Are these great or what? One thing you might have missed was that in addition to getting this tablet, you also received this voucher. This voucher we will actually deliver on today at 3:30. And what you'll get is one of these. This is just absolutely amazing. It's a Verizon Wi-Fi hotspot provided through our partnership with Verizon and Samsung. On typical 4G areas, you'll get up to 20 megabits per second down, 10 megabits per second up. Typical areas do not include this room, but I got about 7 megabits down a few moments ago in the room. But like we said, please turn off your Wi-Fi hotspots for the sake of the presentation. But I hope you enjoy this as well. This is really, really great. Thank you to Samsung and Verizon for that. Let's turn our attention to the keynote this morning. You know, from its very inception, this show has always been about the most important platform of our era. It's a platform that's controlled by none of us, so it's the only platform that truly belongs to all of us, and that is the open web. And the Chrome team has set the pace of moving the web forward along the dimensions of speed, along the dimensions of security, and along the dimensions of capability. To hear what's next in the incredibly exciting story of Chrome, I'd like to introduce my friend and Senior Vice President of Chrome, Sundar Pichai.
Thank you. It's very exciting to be here. Welcome to the Chrome keynote. We have a lot to cover. We are here to talk about the open web, the amazing platform it is, the pace at which it's making progress. Chrome is the way we manifest the web to our users, so we want to give you an update on Chrome, Chrome Web Store, and finally Chrome OS. So lots to cover, let's get started. Exactly a year ago at Google I/O, we were here on the stage. We were incredibly excited at the momentum behind Chrome. We announced that over 70 million active users were using Chrome as their main browser. So it's been a year since then, and we are back at I/O, so let's take a look at where we are now. So we have more than doubled in the last year, and we couldn't be more pleased. Many of you in this audience were some of the earliest adopters of Chrome and helped get the word around, so thank you. Let's take a look at what's happened since last I/O to now, within the last year. So let's zoom in between the 70 to 160 million. If you take a look, it's actually a bit tough to remember, but last year we were at Chrome 4. So we had just launched the stable version of Chrome 4, and if you remember, it was available only for Windows. We didn't have Mac and Linux versions. In fact, that's what most of the team was working on, getting Chrome to be an equal citizen on the two other great platforms. It was a lot of work. It consumed a lot of resources. And with Chrome 6, we brought Chrome to the Mac and Linux stable channel. At that point, we made an important decision as a team. We decided to switch to 6-week release cycles. We wanted to make sure version numbers shouldn't matter, that we continually push features out, both to users and, more importantly, to developers as and when HTML5 APIs became ready. So let's take a look. As you can see, in the last 12 months, we've been releasing every 6 weeks, and this week we just launched Chrome 12 in beta. So we've had over 8 versions of Chrome just in the last year alone. The pace at which we are pushing the web platform forward is amazing. There are a whole slew of APIs here. We'll talk about them in more detail, but we are focused on many other things as well. Speed is something near and dear to our heart. We've had over 20x speed in JavaScript improvement last year alone. We've pushed security really hard. You know, Chrome has a great sandbox. In addition, last year, for the first time, we have sandboxed plugins. PDF is fully sandboxed, and Flash is partially sandboxed, and we are working on completing the sandbox. So the progress has been great. The good news is we are not the only ones pushing the platform forward. All browser vendors, modern browsers, are investing in HTML5. So if you take a look at 2008, this was just underway. Chrome had launched. People were beginning to add HTML5 APIs. We spoke about it in I/O, and if you forward to now, the progress is amazing. All modern browsers have these APIs implemented so that you as developers can rely on these APIs when you write applications and make sure you can deliver a consistent experience. So let's take a look at some of the upcoming APIs which we are excited about in Chrome. And to do that, I want to invite Ian Ellison-Taylor, who's the director of the web platform team in Chrome.
It's a long way out. Thanks, everybody. So as Sundar showed on an earlier slide, there's been an amazing number of new features added to the web platform just over the last year alone. And I think taken together, they add up to an amazing new set of capabilities for web applications running in modern browsers. I think it's amazing the kinds of things that you can build today. Now, of course, we're not resting on our laurels. At Google and with hundreds, literally hundreds of other collaborators, new features are being added all the time. It's a genuine community effort on everyone's part. So I wanted to take a minute or two today and just run you through some of those features. And I'm going to start with, I think, one of my favorite features, one of the new and cool features, and that's speech. So let me run through that here and give you a quick demo. So for the purposes of the demo, I'm going to use this application. It's a fantastic application from the web store. It's called Clicker. It lets you discover and view some of the best online web video. So imagine for a second I'm an engineer at Clicker, and I want to add speech to this. So here's the little search panel inside Clicker, and I want to add some speech support. So there's lots of ways to do it. One of the easiest ways just to try things out is to use the developer tools that are built into Chrome. So I'm going to right-click on Inspect Element, and then this brings up the developer tools that you can see in the bottom panel. Now, the developer tools in Chrome have come a really long way in the last year or so. I think many of these features, I think, are state of the art. So I very much encourage you to check out the developer tools session a little bit later. I'm just going to focus on a couple of quick features here. So I'm just going to right-click and add attributes. And I'm going to add the x-webkit. Oh, how about if I type properly? Speech attribute, and I can close the dev tools. And so sort of as if by magic, this little microphone appeared. Now, I haven't done anything else. I haven't added any event handlers or written any code. I just added that one attribute to this application that wasn't originally designed with speech in mind. OK, so that's adding the attribute. Let's give it a try and see if this works. Now, I should caveat that one of the first rules of keynotes is never, ever do live speech demos. The acoustics in the room make it really hard. But we're going to try anyway. And I figure if it goes absolutely horribly wrong, it will at least be entertaining. So let's see what happens. So one of my favorite shows right now is called Bandwagon. It stars Emma Caulfield from Buffy and a host of other movies. So I'm going to search for that and see what happens. So let's try this. Emma Caulfield. Oh, it works. My gosh. You have no idea how I am genuinely surprised. I'm genuinely surprised that worked. And here's Bandwagon, the show. And I can click through and watch it very quickly. So let's close that. So that's fantastic. It did well with my bizarre English / American accent. So as you can imagine, at Google, we're adding speech support to a lot of our applications as well. So one I want to show you quickly, and one of my favorites is Translate. And this is something, I like showing this because I genuinely need this. I am terrible at foreign languages. And so this is a great way to do a quick translation, and you can try this out. Now, I'm going to do a translation from English into Chinese. I think Chinese is the language I am least likely to learn in the future, so this is a good test. Like I said, this has already been modified, so it has the little microphone icon down here. Welcome to San Francisco. Oh, it works. Amazing. All right, so it's taken the speech, translated it into Chinese, and we can listen to this now. Okay, one more time. So I don't actually speak Chinese, so I have no idea if that was actually correct. Does anyone? Yeah, people are nodding. Yes, all right. I was afraid there for a second I was going to insult someone's mother, but I think we did okay. All right. So that's just quickly that speech. So new features are fantastic, of course, but performance is a feature too. And making things fast has been one of the sort of fundamental founding criteria of Chrome since the very early days. So you can see behind me, this is a little chart of JavaScript performance. And this is back in 2008, and this is the best of. This isn't just Chrome. This is what was the state of the art of JavaScript back in the day. And if you look at what's happened since then, up to Chrome 11, the progress on JavaScript has been truly phenomenal. It's fundamentally changed the kinds of applications that you can build on the web. And you know, in some respects, I'm kind of hoping I never show this chart again. We're going to continue to work on JavaScript performance, of course. But the good news here is really it's no longer the bottleneck that it used to be. And so we're beginning to focus more of our attention on some of the areas, other areas of the web platform, where there are more opportunities to make performance improvements. Now, one of the key areas is, of course, graphics, and specifically GPU acceleration, using the GPU to hardware accelerate graphics and get the best out of the performance of your modern laptop, as well as improve battery life. So one of the easiest ways to do that is just using CSS transforms. I know many of you will have been using CSS for a while now. It's super easy to do. And it's in beta right now in Chrome, where those are now GPU accelerated. So you don't have to do anything to your applications. Just keep using CSS, and things will just get magically faster. So CSS is great. Now, a level up from CSS in terms of capability is Canvas 2D. Canvas 2D is particularly important because it's used for a lot of games. And in games, one of the most common operations that you want to do and have be fast is sprite animation, moving lots of little images or animated characters zipping around. So that's one of the areas that we've been focusing on heavily in the latest releases of Chrome. So I'm going to give you a quick demo of what that looks like in Chrome. So for the purposes of the demo, I'm going to use the famous, some would say infamous, fishy demo, courtesy of Microsoft. So this is Chrome running in software. It does pretty well with 20 fish, but if you go up to, say, like 100, or let's go to 500, you can see there the frame rate's dropping, and we're under 10 frames a second. So here's a new version of Chrome with GPU acceleration turn on for the canvas. You can see here at 100 frames a second, 100 fish, it's still doing 60 frames a second. Go up to 250. Keep going, 500. Thank you, thank you. You can applause. Thanks. So it's not until we get to 1,000 fish that you start to see it going. We're below 60 frames a second. So that's basically a 10x improvement over where we were. So I think that's phenomenal. And again, you didn't have to do anything. Things just got faster. So definitely try out Canvas 2D. I think that's phenomenal. But wait, there's more. So doing this kind of sprite animation is actually something that WebGL is extremely good at doing. So our friends at Mozilla actually took the fishy demo and ported it over to use WebGL. So let's look at 1,000 fish straight away. Let's just jump to that. So that's too easy. 2,000, still too easy. 10,000, all right. So now we're up to 10,000 or so sprites and still doing around 30 frames a second. So this is another 10x performance improvement. And it's very easy to move that kind of sprite animation over to WebGL. It's a fantastic way to take advantage of the performance of a modern laptop. I think this is pretty phenomenal. Thanks. Yes, pause for applause. So do definitely give that a try. Now, WebGL can be used for lots of things. It's not just good for sprite animation. It is full 3D. So I wanted to show an example of a sort of a more traditional 3D application. So this is Tinkercad that lets you do a little bit of design on a surface here. And I'm going to just quickly draw some shapes. And I have to apologize for not being a designer and not having any artistic ability or whatsoever. But I can build a little model surface, and I can quickly sort of punch holes in the surface. Let's pick that. So I can do some sort of solid geometry modeling. And this is all running in the browser, and I can sort of zoom in and out. And the performance of this is absolutely fantastic. So I didn't have to install any plugins. This is just using the inherent 3D support that's in the browser now. So I think this is pretty cool. And Tinkercad, in particular, I think it's fantastic. You should try this out, because it lets you export these 3D models and send them to a 3D printer, so you can actually build the things that you design, which I think is absolutely phenomenal. So that's it for WebGL and some features. So those are great features. And of course, there's going to be lots more to come. There's hundreds of features coming in a build near you. So stay tuned for upcoming releases. And with that, I thank you.
Thank you, Ian. Speed is the fundamental underpinning behind Chrome, and I think these GPU acceleration improvements is going to make Chrome much faster. In fact, for example, if you were writing a game about 6 months ago, and you were writing it in Canvas and software, and if you can now write it in WebGL, GPU accelerated, it's going to be about 100 times faster. So that's the pace at which the web is evolving. Of course, writing these applications only matter if you can reach users, which is why about 3 months ago, in the stable channel of the US, we launched the Chrome Web Store. The goal behind the Web Store was to help developers reach users and monetize their applications. In the first 3 months since we have launched, we've had an amazing early traction. We've had over 17 million applications installed. And more importantly, developers have informed us that people spend a lot more time in their application when they install it from the Chrome Web Store. To give you some examples, roughly we see about a 2x increase in the amount of time spent per app when installed from the Web Store. SpringPad, which is a productivity application, has noticed this increase, and so have many others. And games. Games have seen about 2.5 times increase in transactions when users have installed the game in the Web Store. So we are taking the Web Store, and as of today, we are making it available in 41 languages to all 160 million users of Chrome. We are very excited that you as developers can write an application and reach the entire install base of Chrome. When you write these applications, there are two aspects to it. The first is reach, so we want to make sure you can reach all users of Chrome. But more importantly, we want to make sure you can monetize your applications. This is why when we launched Chrome Web Store, we offer the ability for you to charge for your applications. But we want to constantly explore more options by which developers can monetize. One of the problems on the web today, it's very tough to charge users in context within your application without breaking the flow. So we want to create a seamless payments experience for developers and users alike. To talk about that, let me invite Vikas Gupta, product manager from the Google Payments team.
Thank you, Sundar. Hello, everyone. I'm tremendously excited to be here today to talk about in-app payments. In some ways, it's the culmination of a vision that our team's been working on for the past few years. It started with a basic idea that we can make purchases within applications extremely frictionless, extremely seamless, so that users who are engaged in your applications can stay engaged while they make a purchase. It should be really easy for developers to implement it, and it should be just as secure and reliable as every online purchase should be. What's even more exciting for us today is that we're delivering that vision at Google scale. This means you can take this and take it to users everywhere on the web. Let me show you a little bit of how it works. This is an application built by Graphically. It's available in the Chrome Web Store. It lets you discover, browse, read, and enjoy comic books and graphic novels on the web. It's a great, fun experience, and I highly encourage all of you to go check it out. One of the things that Graphically wanted to do was to let users start reading the comic book before they've made a purchase. And once a user starts enjoying it, starts getting hooked, that's when give them the option to actually make a purchase within there. It's now possible with our API. And it's really simple. With a single click, the user can initiate the purchase, and with another click, complete and go back to reading the comic book they were originally enjoying. That's it. That's all it takes for a user to make a purchase within the application. Let me show you how it works. Just like we wanted to make it really easy for users to make those purchases, we also wanted to make it stunningly simple for developers to implement it. All it takes for you to implement this is a single line of code. There's one line of code that integrates it and lets the initiates a purchase flow where the users can go make a purchase. And once the purchase flow completes, you get a callback that you can take in your application and deliver the goods with a single line of code. That's all it is. And the session later today, we will talk about this platform and the API in a lot more detail, and I highly encourage you to go check that out. Now, there's one more thing. We wanted to make it simple for users. We wanted to make it simple for developers to implement it. We also wanted to figure out how do we price it so that all of you can build amazing businesses on this platform. When we looked around, we found that applications tend to pay a very complicated set of fees. There are set of fees, there are minimum fees, there are monthly fees, there are fixed fees. We wanted to keep it simple. We also found out that online applications and social games are starting to pay to the tune of 30% for payment fees. 30%. Well, we at Google felt we could do a little better. So I'm glad to announce today that this platform that you can integrate into your applications with a single line of code can deliver your users this amazingly, stunningly simple purchase experience and take it to everywhere on the web is priced at a flat fee of 5%. I'm sure you've done the math, but let me do the simple math for you. Of all the money that people spend in applications, 95% stays with you. We believe that's a great thing for developers and a great thing for the web. Thank you.
Wow. For 5%, it almost wants me to go out and write a web application and implement in-app payments right now. So we are very excited about this feature. We hope all of you take advantage of it. And the ability to offer payments in context without breaking the experience for users can be a game changer on the web. So we are very excited about it. Next, we want to showcase a game for you. this game couldn't have been on the web a year ago. It's available on many platforms. It's one of the leading games in the world. But to do that on the web was difficult. But thanks to the recent improvements, the great GPU capabilities which you just saw, they've been able for the first time to bring their game onto the web. To talk about this game, let me invite the one and the only Mighty Eagle, also known as Peter Westerbaka from Rovio.
Yeah, so are we ready for some fun and games? Yeah. So, thanks, Sundar. It's really great to be here. And we wanted to bring Angry Birds to the web for a long, long time. But you know Angry Birds. It's a great experience on all the platforms, all the devices that we support. So we didn't want to compromise on the performance. And okay, we're not, making like fish swimming in a bowl or anything like that, but it's all about like Angry Birds and some really, really angry birds. And of course, one of the reasons we've been angry is that we haven't been able to bring this to the web. So, it's really hasn't been possible until today. And today, reason I'm here is actually because we are bringing Angry Birds to the biggest platform out there, the web. And it's really a great version of Angry Birds. I mean, it's one of the best that we built to date. And it really is as fun, as engaging as any of the versions that we have out there right now. But again, don't take my word for it. We actually have the real thing here. So why don't we play some Angry Birds? Khan, go ahead, take it away. Yeah. And Khan, if you, pop some of those pigs, clear some of those levels, maybe we'll get you one of these, like, cool hoodies afterwards. So, as you can see, this is the Angry Birds that I'm sure you played, for a few hours. And it really plays really, really well. And, on most modern PCs, we get 60 frames per second easily. So it really, really is a very, very smooth, very, very nice Angry Birds experience. And again, of course, at Rovio, we wouldn't settle for anything less. So it has to be great. And we think that we built a really great version here for Chrome. And we built this using WebGL. So It really rocks, as you can see. But if your browser, for some reason, doesn't support WebGL, we also support Canvas. So, that works as well. And if your browser supports hardware acceleration, then you get the HD experience that you just saw. So it looks and plays really, really well. But then, again, if you don't have hardware acceleration, we have a fallback, so you can still play the game. I mean, it's not the perfect experience, but it's still like really, really good. So it's all there. Another like really cool thing. So okay, it's browser-based and all of that. So what if you're offline? What we've done is we use local storage. And again, because we are in the Chrome web store, we can get some extra, app cache, extra storage. So you can play the complete game offline. So again, really, really cool. So now we'll make those flights more bearable. So when you run out of battery in your Android device, you can continue on your like Chrome, netbook, and like goes on and on. So it works offline, and it's really, really fantastic. But again. And as you probably figured by now, so we think Chrome is a great environment for Angry Birds. So we didn't want to stop there. We wanted to offer a special treat only for the users of Chrome. And I guess we have a few of you here in this room, I guess. you know, just guessing. Anyway, so we built something very special for Chrome. So we built some special exclusive levels that are only available in Chrome. So let's enter the Chrome dimension. So you see some familiar things in there. So we have, you know, some of these Chrome buttons as rocks. There's, you know, some Chrome flowers, some Chrome clouds. It's a very, like, Chrome experience. And we even have something really cool. We have the Chrome bombs. So, I mean, how cool is that? And, yeah, I can see that Khan, you know, is... you need to play some more. I mean, it's clear. But, okay, it's new levels. I'm sure Khan would clear, like, the original ones, like, easily. But, again, you know, it happens that you fail a level, and sometimes you can be stuck on a level for hours, even days, weeks, I've heard. So we have a solution for that. And really, really happy to hear about the 5%. You know, we really love that kind of model. You know, as a developer, you know, that's fair. So we're all for lower taxes, and 5% fair. So anyway, what we decided to do when we heard about the 5%, we're actually going to bring the Mighty Eagle that we actually been offering only on one platform so far. We're going to bring that to Chrome. So as soon as the in-app payments are live, we'll be there with the Mighty Eagle that you can buy right from your browser, and you can use the Mighty Eagle to clear the levels. So that will be available very, very soon on Chrome. And the game, it's there. So again, yeah, you probably are interested also in how we actually deliver this. So we use some other Google tools. So we use the web toolkit. So all of what you see here was done in Java using the web toolkit. Actually didn't take us that long to get the game over. So it was a very smooth experience as well. Then we're hosting everything on App Engine. And I've been told that it should basically be able to cope with all of you going and getting the game right after the keynote. So you know, don't worry about that. You know, feel free, go get the game. It's available right after this. So I really encourage you to do that. But yeah, I don't think that there's much more to say. I mean, we could be here playing Angry Birds for like all day, and you know, that's a good thing to do. And it's okay to play, you know, like out there. That's not a problem at all. We actually encourage you to play Angry Birds whenever you can. But so you know, it happens. And you know, like just look like you're like browsing some important files or something. But anyway, really happy with finally being able to bring Angry Birds to the web. So after this, go get it. You know, let's pop some pigs and play Angry Birds. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. It's been a long journey building Chrome for over 4.5 years. And I have to say, this is the culmination point, seeing Angry Birds finally work in Chrome. More importantly, I think my kids will think finally I'm doing something useful. And I'm going to be buying a lot of Mighty Eagles. So it's great to see a game like Angry Birds, which couldn't have been on the web a year ago, be here today running fast, full HD, and very, very smooth. So that shows the pace at which the platform is evolving. This is what we can do on the web today, but there's a whole lot more you can do. The web is what you make of it. To give a glimpse into the future, what the future of the web can be, let me invite Aaron Koblin from the Google Creative Lab team.
Thanks a lot, Sundar. Some of you may remember the HTML5 music project that we launched last year called The Wilderness Downtown with the band Arcade Fire. Well, this year I'm really excited to give you a sneak preview of a new interactive music project we're working on called Three Dreams of Black. So Three Dreams of Black is an interactive music experience which really showcases the power of JavaScript, HTML5, and especially WebGL to make an immersive, interactive, multimedia 3D experience for the web. So we worked with some amazing people. Since this is a music experience, we teamed up with Chris Milk, who wrote and directs the script. And it's based off some music off of Danger Mouse and Daniel Lupi's new album called Rome, featuring Jack White from the White Stripes and Norah Jones. So basically, the experience is moving you through a variety of dream worlds. And it's involving composited video, animation, and 3D graphics all into one space. So I'm going to give you a little demo of what that looks like. So the experience starts off with some 2D animation. It's all going with the music. And it allows you to actually look around and see various parallax and panorama views. You can also apply real-time shaders, like I'm applying to this parrot right here. And as it goes through the storyline, you'll see here it's driving through this car, and it's going to dump us into some amazing 3D interactive worlds. I'm just going to let this play through. So as you can see, I'm literally painting with geometry. I'm going to move to skip ahead to a separate section. This is going through a prairie sequence. And I'm literally painting with shader effects and doing collision detection, spawning animals and separate animated elements, and interacting with the environment in real time, all being rendered live. And you can explore these various dream realities and kind of progress through the storyline. The other really cool thing is you can actually contribute to the storyline yourself. So I'm going to skip ahead to the UGC tool. And here you can choose what type of element you're going to contribute to the experience. And there's a basic voxel building tool. And you can begin to build your own models right into the experience itself. So we're really excited about the types of things people are going to create with this. But I think equally exciting to the project is actually the process behind it. So the entire thing's open source. And we released a bunch of demos that show exactly how we put it together. So on this tech page, you'll see some demos. Like there's this GLSL shader demo with hatching glow shader. There's normal mapping, showing how we did some of the video compositing, depth of field. There's some really cool demos on here, and they're all open source. And you can view the code directly within the site. So we hopefully you'll get a chance to take a look at some of those. We also built this model viewer, which allows you to take a look at some of the assets that are part of the project. And you could toggle things like texture. You can do wireframing, see how the models were built. I'm just going to show you a couple of my favorite models. This is a bear that morphs into a horse. Or this is really my favorite. This is a buffalo that goes into a tarantula, the tarantulo. And you can actually do some fun stuff like control the morphing speed yourself with JavaScript and some really cool things. And a lot of this was built with a library that I wanted to give a shout out to called 3.js. Some of you may know the developer, Mr. Doob, and he's worked with us to build this. I definitely recommend you check it out. So at the bottom of the page, there's a link to that. We're also going to put up a link to processing.js, which is a great starting point for people who are interested in learning how to use WebGL. And again, the code base is linked down there. So we're going to be launching the project really soon. You can keep your eyes out at ro.me as the URL. If you're interested in checking out other WebGL demos, we also have a section on Chrome experiments. So if you go to chromeexperiments.com/WebGL, you can see a number of these demos as well. Thanks a lot, and talk to you soon.
Thank you, Aaron. So that's an inspiring look at how the future of websites could look like. In fact, was it a website, a video, a game? You get to decide. So we've spent the last 30 minutes talking about the power of the web, the pace at which the platform is evolving, and the momentum behind Chrome. It turns out this is what people do almost entirely on their computers now, spend all their time on the web within a browser, which is why we set out to do ChromeOS. Let's take a brief look at what computers look like today. Just to spend your time on the web within a browser, you have to deal with all the legacy decisions which have been made in the last 20 to 30 years in operating system. Every time you boot up the computer, some computers even check to see whether there's a floppy drive. It takes a long time to boot into your computer. Once you're inside, you have to make sure you manage your applications. Every one of your applications need to be up to date. You have to run antivirus software. You have to back up your data. If you move across machines or if you try to upgrade your PC, good luck with that. It takes an entire weekend to do so. the experience is really, really complicated. So we wanted to rethink the entire experience and distill it down to nothing but the web. And that's what Chrome OS is. Chrome OS can be applied to a variety of form factors. It is just an end-to-end computing experience, a software experience. It can be applied to a variety of form factors. We have chosen to focus initially on notebooks because that's where most of the web usage is there today. That's where people use the web the most, and so we wanted to bring the Chrome OS experience to notebooks. When you do that, when you run Chrome OS on notebooks, you end up with a very different, unique experience. We call those Chromebooks. So what makes Chromebooks different from other notebooks? Here are a few attributes. Every Chromebook is instant to turn on. In fact, when you first get your device, when you unwrap the box, you will be up and running within 3 minutes. If you're one of the 160 million active users of Chrome, all your stuff is automatically there with Chrome Sync. Every time you boot up, you're up and running within 8 seconds. And each time you open the lid, before you can move your fingers and type on the keyboard, you're connected within the web. We have provided built-in connectivity options. So wherever you use them, with connectivity options, you have data services which are pay-as-you-go, no contracts, no commitments. You get free monthly usage per month, and you can buy day passes, et cetera. So you can be always connected. They have all-day battery life. So I think this is really game-changing in terms of how you think about your notebooks. I never carry power chargers around when I'm using a Chromebook. It lasts them all day, and as long as you can charge it at home or at your hotel in the night, you're all set. These are some of the attributes which make phones and tablets great as well. But for the first time, we are bringing those wonderful attributes of mobile computing to the world of notebooks. The software experience is very unique as well. Because it is nothing but the web, you can access your stuff anytime, anywhere. You can have multiple Chromebooks. You can share Chromebooks with people. Each time when you open them, you get the latest and the greatest version of the web application which you're using. It gets better over time. I think this is something, a concept which people aren't used to on their computers. When you buy a PC, it's actually great on the first day, but as you install applications, it slowly starts degrading over time. Because we update Chromebooks automatically, we'll update them every few weeks, we actually think we can make it better over time. To give you an example, as we have made all the JavaScript speed improvements, your Chromebooks will get faster. With all the GPU acceleration improvements we talked about, you will notice in a few months your Chromebooks are even faster. And finally, security is built in from the ground up. Every piece of user data on Chromebooks, by default, is encrypted. Every time you boot up your computer, we take you through a verified boot sequence to make sure you're secure. And finally, you're within the Chrome sandbox. Chrome sandbox, which is built into sandbox web pages and plugins. So we think it's a pretty unique experience. We started testing out Chromebooks through the CR48 pilot program about 6 months ago. Just after announcing it, within the first few weeks, we had over 1 million applicants. People had to fill long forms and submit it, and so we were humbled by the interest in the program. We have literally shipped thousands of devices to people all over the US and even internationally. The feedback has been great. I mean, it's an open forum on the web, so you can take a look. People have had meetups, they've printed t-shirts, they've been very vocal with suggestions, they've written us hundreds of emails. The good news is we've been working on many of the same features over the last months. We have fixed some issues we had with CR48. We have completely revamped the trackpad to end-to-end a much better trackpad. We have worked closely with Adobe, our partner, to have a seamless flash experience on Chromebooks. Intel, who powers these devices, has worked with us to upgrade to a dual-core processor so that Chromebooks can be much faster. There were missing gaps when we announced CR48 about 6 months ago. As we showed in the event, if you plugged in a camera, nothing happened. But it turns out now, if you plug in a camera, something interesting happens. To show you what it is, we'll invite Ken Liu, who's a product manager on Chrome OS.
Thanks, Sundar. Hopefully I'll do better with this than I did with Angry Birds.
I'm very excited to show you guys some of the new file features and functionality that we've been building directly into Chrome OS. We think it's going to make our users' lives a lot easier. Let's start with a very common scenario that a lot of users have. Someone emails you a file, and you want to be able to save it for later viewing or use. In this particular case, my friend Rahul has emailed me HTML5 Canvas cheat sheet, so I'll stop nagging him with my annoying questions. And I'm going to go ahead and download this. And as you can see, it downloads immediately. And now I can close it. And if I ever wanted to get back to it, I have to open up the new file manager that we built into Chrome OS, which I've already got opened in another tab. And I can just drill into the folder. And there's the file. Double click, opens instantly. So it's very simple, very easy to use. Now, of course, we realize that people have a lot of other important data types. For example, a lot of users have music, media, movies, and so forth that they want to be able to play on this device as well. So let's see how that works. I'm going to go back to the file manager. And here I've got a USB drive full of some of my favorite music and movies. I'm going to go into the music folder. And let's just try to open one of these and see what happens. And it opens immediately in the new media player that we've added as well. It's very simple, very easy to use. You can do basic things, skip, pause. You can even create new playlists and so forth. But now let's try a video. So let's go back. And I've got here a bunch of movie trailers of some of my favorite movies. But I've also got a Chrome versus potato gun video, which I'm very, very excited about. Because let's face it, who doesn't like potato guns, right? So let's watch this. Now, again, it opens immediately in the media player in the panel form factor. So I can now go back to checking my email or reading news or whatever while continuing to watch. Of course, if I wanted to focus purely on just on the video, I can easily full screen it as well. So let's watch this for a second. So as you can see, as awesome as potato guns are, they're clearly no match for Chrome. One of the trends that we're seeing is more and more users are starting to move to online media consumption. So they're streaming their content directly from web services. For example, yesterday, we actually launched two great services, Movie Rentals, right, and Google Music Beta, which all work seamlessly on this device as well, because again, it's just the web. Yes. Now, of course, all your other favorite online services, like Hulu or Amazon or even Netflix, which we've been working closely with, will also just work out of the box. And same with your music, your Moog, your Pandora, and so forth. Now, another important media type that a lot of users have today is photos. A very common use case is you're at an event, maybe I/O, maybe a birthday, maybe a party of some sort, and you take a whole bunch of photos that you want to be able to share with your friends. So how does that work on Chrome OS? Well, I've got here an SD card full of photos I took at my daughter's recent birth that I'm very excited to share with my friends. So I'm just going to go ahead and plug it in. And now, because Chromebooks are cloud devices, we wanted to make it really easy, really seamless for users to get their files, their important data, directly into the cloud so that they can have it accessible to them from anywhere, as well as easily share those with other people. So as you can see, it's automatically opened up a new file manager directly in the SD card. So I can start clicking through on my photos. I can preview them. I can select a bunch and play a slideshow if I wanted to. But most importantly for me, I just want to get these in the cloud as soon as possible so I can share it with some of my friends who came over to visit. Now, because I'm a Picasa user, I've gone ahead and installed the Picasa web app from the Chrome Web Store. And by doing so, the app has actually registered itself as a local file handler for image file types on this device. So now when I select three photos, a new contextual button pops up that says Send to Picasa, directly in line with the file manager. So I'm going to go ahead and click this. And I can create a new album, say Baby and Friends. Make this private, and upload. And immediately it starts uploading in the background. So I can now go back, continue checking my email, browse around the web. And when it's done, it'll tell me and give me a link to view it online. And there it is. very fast, very easy, and now I'm ready to share with the world. Now, of course, this works with other data types as well. For example, your documents, your presentations, your spreadsheets, and so forth. So let's go back, and here I have a doc that I've been working on for Google I/O that I want to share with my friends. And again, because I'm a Google Docs user, I've already installed the Google Docs app, and it's registered itself as a file handler for doc types. So I'm going to go ahead and click Open with Google Docs, Upload, and I'm done. It's already in the cloud. Now, the best part is we've built these APIs directly into the platform so that any web service, any web app, can leverage these same APIs to build the same great experience for all their users, too. For example, we've been working with Box.net, one of the leading online storage providers, to build the same great app for their users so they can seamlessly upload docs and files directly into Box. So let me show you how that works. I've got a PDF here, and I've got a button that says Save to Box.net. And I'm going to click it, and bam, it's in the cloud already. I'm ready to go to Box.net and share this with others. It's just that simple. And of course, we're working with a lot of other service providers as well, like Dropbox, for example, to build the same great experience for them. And the best part is this is actually really, really easy to use or to build apps on. It literally took Box.net less than one weekend leveraging their existing upload APIs and some of our new file extension APIs to build this app. So you can imagine in the future, when we've any user should be able to take an image from their SD card and open it directly in an online photo editor. Or if someone sends me a CAD file, I should be able to open that directly in Tinkercad. We're really trying to open up the world of your offline files to the web so that any web app can actually register themselves and handle your local files. And so it's our hope that you, as web app developers, as web service writers, will leverage these same APIs to create the exact same great experience and seamless experience for all your users as well. And with that, I'm going to hand it back to Sundar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ken. I'm personally very, very excited by the file extension APIs. The cloud has more storage than any single computer. And so we really want to make it possible for users to store their important data in the cloud and access them anytime, anywhere. And I can't wait to see the interesting use cases you all write on top of these APIs. So we've been working hard to address the important use cases. Another important use case is the ability to use Chromebooks while you're disconnected. So we worked hard to make many, many important applications available offline. Three of the most important applications which users have requested us to bring offline are Gmail, Google Calendar, and Google Docs. We're all using internally offline versions of these applications, and they will all be available for Chromebook users this summer. Already today, there are hundreds of applications on the Chrome Web Store which work offline. New York Times, USA Today, Huffington Post, Sports Illustrated. You should check it out. They work seamlessly offline, and almost all the games, they use package resources, and they work offline in the browser today in the Chrome Web Store. Angry Birds, which you saw earlier, works offline as well. We also realize it's a very connected world, which is why we have brought in seamless connectivity with built-in 3G as well. So we've been working to complete this experience. Back in December, we told you we are working with some of the leading partners in the world to bring Chromebooks to market. We are working with Samsung and Acer, two of the leading companies in the world. Intel powers Chromebooks with their great processors, and Verizon in the US with the Gobi modem has incredible connectivity, and I've been using this app. In fact, the connectivity piece of Chromebooks, we received such great feedback during the pilot program. We have worked internationally to partner with leading carriers all over the world to make the same option available for Chromebooks internationally. So let's take a look at the first Chromebooks. The first Chromebook is from Samsung. Samsung is the world's leading consumer electronics manufacturer. They worked with us very closely to design a Chromebook optimized for web usage. It has a 12.1-inch display It looks great. It's a 300 nit display, and the web looks great on it. It has all-day battery usage. So you literally, I've used it for many days now. You don't run out of battery while you use it during the day. It comes in Wi-Fi, as well as the built-in 3G option from Verizon in the US and other carriers internationally. And it's available in two colors. The second Chromebook is from Acer. Acer is the world's leading PC manufacturer, and they worked to come up with a new Chromebook, which is much more portable. So it has 11.6-inch screen, so it's easy to carry around. It's a full HD display, and but they worked to fit in a full-size keyboard so that you can easily carry it around. It'd be very, very productive on this machine. It's again available in Wi-Fi and 3G. We just want to give you a sneak preview. Our partners will be holding events to announce more details. I should mention that the Samsung device will be priced at $429 for the Wi-Fi option. With the built-in 3G option and 100 megs free built-in, it is $499 in the United States. The Acer device, it's an incredible value. It's priced starting at $349 and up. So when will they be available? On June 15th, we have worked with two of the leading online retailers in the US, Amazon.com and BestBuy.com, so they'll be available online for consumers to order on June 15th. In addition, at the same time, they will be available in six more countries, UK, France, Germany, Netherlands, Spain, and Italy. In each of these countries, they'll be available through leading online retailers and will have 3G options from the top carriers in those countries. So we really hope you get a chance to try out these devices. For folks like you, we realize these devices are designed to be very, very simple to use. So hopefully you can share with your family members. Like a lot of us, I'm sure you all get asked to troubleshoot these devices all the time. So hopefully when you visit Thanksgiving next time, you get to eat more turkey and watch more football. Of course, as you developers, we want to make sure you can completely jailbreak these devices. So my partners may not want to say it, but these devices have full jailbreaking mode built in, and you can play around with the kernel all you want. Another group which suffers from the same complexity in computing are businesses and educational institutions, schools. Let's take a brief look at what their world looks like. In most companies today, the IT infrastructure is so complicated, they actually have a hard time even accounting for the layers and layers of software they have within their companies. In fact, it is so difficult to upgrade operating systems, over 50% of the companies are still running Windows XP. This morning, I checked in Wikipedia. Windows XP was launched in 2001, 10 years ago. So most companies have such a hard time upgrading their operating systems. It is very, very costly to do so. Meanwhile, usage patterns have changed dramatically. 10 years ago, people used to use desktops. Today, most users use laptops. They take it in and out of the enterprise firewall. They're always connected. The security surface area is really challenging for IT administrators to manage. All this adds up as costs for companies. If you just do a rough survey, most companies spend starting from $3,000 to high thousands of dollars per computer per year when they deploy PC environment. So it's really complicated. There is good news. CIOs and IT administrators are well on their way to move things towards the cloud. Cloud computing is real and big in the enterprise. So if you look at it, even many traditional applications are already moving to the cloud. Companies like SAP, Salesforce.com are pioneering this movement, and so you can now, within companies, use all of them as web applications. In addition, many companies are deploying desktop virtualization. So they're taking the traditional applications and bringing them through a browser front end to their users. So for Chromebooks, we have partnered with two of the leading retailers in the space, Citrix and VMware, to make sure the same applications are available in Chromebooks through the browser. When we launched the CR48 pilot program, we had over 50,000 companies apply to test Chromebooks. We We've deployed them in hundreds of companies and thousands of devices. Here are a few examples. Intercontinental Hotels, they have hundreds of call service agents in distributed locations. They've been piloting Chromebooks to great results. A more classic example is Jason's Deli. They have hundreds of retail store locations all over the US. It is so cost prohibitive for them that in many stores, all store managers share one Windows laptop in the back of the store. So we took a few stores, deployed Chromebooks. Every store manager gets one. They've been able to seamlessly manage the deployment. We have tested this with governmental institutions. The city of Orlando, if you go there, you will find Chromebooks in offices, in some cases inside fire trucks, and in some cases even on the streets. In fact, the only piece of feedback they've had is people have asked for more power cords because they're using them everywhere. So this is really, really easy to use. We spent 4 months talking to over 400 companies and had an in-depth survey of whether Chromebooks are applicable. Almost all companies said with the combination of web applications and desktop virtualization, they can migrate 75% of their users today to Chromebooks. So we want to make it available to them. The same two Chromebooks, which are available for consumers, will be available for businesses as well. In addition, when we talk with them, not everyone has a mobile use case. For example, think retail store locations. They want a box from which they can drive large monitors. Google engineers wanted the same thing as well. So they want a box from which they can drive really large monitors. So we are working on a Chromebox as well, which we think will be ideal for many, many companies. So how will we offer this? As I said earlier, the device is only one part of the cost. Most of the expenses are in management and administration. So we have worked to design a web console. So just from a web page, IT administrators can centrally manage all Chromebooks. They can add and remove users. They can install apps, remove applications, have centralized group policy settings for their entire employee base. It's dead simple to manage. We want to make it really easy for them to manage their computing. So we have an end-to-end offering. We call this Chromebooks for Business. For the first time, it is software and hardware as a service packaged together. So what do companies get? They get the devices, they get Chromebooks. You get a centralized web console. You get full support. You get warranty and replacements. So if your device breaks down, we ship you a new device. And when the hardware life cycle is over, we automatically upgrade you to the next generation Chromebook. All for a convenient monthly price of $28 per user. Software and hardware as a service. We think this can fundamentally change the way people use computing in companies. Another area which we passionately care about is schools. It's incredible that in today's age, most schools can't provide computers for their students. Again, the reasons are the same. You can go and buy a cheap PC, but it's impossible. We've talked to every school. It's impossible to manage a deployment of 1,000 PCs in a cost-effective manner. They just cannot afford it. So we want to make it possible for every student to have a computer in schools as well. So we have worked with our partners, and Chromebooks for Education is priced at $20 per user for schools and governmental institutions. So when are these available? Just like for consumers, starting June 15th, Chromebooks are available for companies and schools and governments. You can order them directly from Google, and they are available in the same 7 countries. Both consumers and businesses can go and find all the information they want at google.com/Chromebook. Many of us, as we were working on the project, we were asked to describe what Chromebooks are. And I'm sure a lot of you will get asked the same question as well. So to help that, we put together a little something which describes what Chromebooks are. Let's take a look.
This is a laptop. This is a computer. This has the web? That's weird. Okay, so it's the web. There are no programs? So there's nothing to start up. Then how do I do stuff? There's no messy desktop. So no rolling hills of green. Can I use it anywhere? On a unicycle? My calendars, emails, documents. Everything can be saved to the web. That's crazy. So I could throw this thing into a river. And I won't lose my stuff? It doesn't need virus protection. What about annoying updates? Or patches. Or patches for the patches. So it gets better in real time. I wonder if people are ready for this. It's kind of a new thought.
We think users are really ready for this. So we want to make sure we make them available, and we are incredibly excited about getting them to test this out. The web is what you make of it. Many of you in the audience here are really helped Chrome get early traction and get the word out to our users. So we hope you all get a chance to try out Chromebooks and help spread the word as well. In fact, which is why we want to make sure every I/O attendee gets a free Chromebook. These are available on June 15th. We will send you an email with details so that you can claim your Chromebook very, very soon. The web is the most amazing platform. The web is the most amazing platform, development platform in our lifetimes. The future of the web is in the hands of a lot of you in the audience. We hope you continue to write great applications, and the web is what you make of it. Thank you.